There are a lot of great questions from everybody on today's episode, but the best one is, why am I wearing these sunglasses? And you're going to want to find out.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Welcome in.
Boo!
I don't know what to tell you, Mike.
Make the noise.
Make it. We want to hear it.
There it is.
I'm just happy to be sitting in this chair again. I'm sorry, you're going to have to wait a little longer for your prototypical introduction to the show. Andy, Mike, and Jason, back together again. My voice is on the way back.
There's just silliness happening in this office. You have your voice situation.
Jason's in sunglasses.
Say, those who have tuned into youtube.com/thefantasyfootballers, you'll notice that Jason has sunglasses on because he has an infected eyeball.
one of my eyeballs is a piece of crap. It's just not. It's the worst. I have a sty, and it hurts a lot. Like, significantly. Mm. And I'm sparing everybody by wearing the sunglasses. The good news is,
I promise you, you should be happy out there that he's wearing the sunglasses.
Oh, for sure.
Even on the podcast side, you should be happy. This could come through the airwaves.
Every time I've brought these bad dogs out before, we've had a good time. So I'm just going to say my mind. This isn't even me. This is just the hate blocker version.
Say my mind.
The hate blocker version of me.
It's Tuesday, March 10th. This is the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. We have buy, sell today. We have some mailbag. Not having a voice for a week was terrible. It really impacted my whole, my kids are back in flag football. All of our kids are doing that right now. And apparently, I'm a very vocal dad because I felt like I had no ability to, like, influence this game. Like, you know, I couldn't cheer my kid on. I couldn't be like, watch out for that guy over there, because I was just completely silent.
So even, like, you couldn't boo?
I couldn't even boo my kids.
Mm, that's a shame.
I've always got enough to boo.
Yeah.
I couldn't celebrate, but when he did something wrong, I got those boo birds out.
Mike, were you going to add something?
Well, it was like, leave it to Jason to...
To say my mind?
It's not that. I mean, that was perfect lead-in, but just, you go from... Who you are, Jason Moore, that you express your opinions, you stand by your takes, and then, like, you're like the kid in Big Daddy, where you're putting the sunglasses on, and all of a sudden it's like people can't see you any longer.
It's 100% right.
So now I'm an egg on Twitter, and I just go and I say just incendiary things and set the world on fire.
Nothing's really that different.
Well,
from normal.
But it's just like, it's so funny to me that sunglasses, he feels like this layer of protection.
He's anonymous. He's anonymous.
100%. This isn't, look, the views and opinions expressed here are only my own, and by my own I mean sunglass version of me.
You're like witness protection mode Jason Moore right now.
You should have a hood and a mustache.
Oh my goodness. You can find us on Twitter at the FF Ballers. I promise not to tweet any pictures of Jason's infected eyeball. Mm.
Thank you.
Instagram.com.
I make no such promises.
/fantasyfootballers. Thefantasyfootballers.com is the website. We've got a couple rookie profile articles up there. Justin Herbert, DeAndre Swift. Definitely check those out at thefantasyfootballers.com. We have a brand new giveaway. We're giving away a baby blue signed Keenan Allen jersey.
Baby blue.
It's beautiful. You can find it at footclangiveaway.com. Completely free giveaway. Got another one of those up there. And then we have a big announcement.
Oh, yes.
We have the winner of the Ultimate Draft Kit pre-order contest that was going on. Anybody who pre-ordered the Ultimate Draft Kit on or before March 1st was eligible to win a Listener League spot, but we have the winner.
Do we have a drum roll over there?
Probably not. Today we don't have Brooks. We have we've got the birthday boy.
Oh, that's right.
Al Borland. How you doing, Al?
You forgot?
I'm good. How are you?
Superman does good.
Doing well. One of you guys want to make the announcement? You want to go ahead and take it away?
Go ahead, hate me.
Anonymous Jason.
Yes. Congratulations out there to Jane M. You have been contacted, and you are the first 2020 new listener league entry in the league.
Congratulations.
It's exciting times, and I apologize in advance for how good we are at fantasy football, destroying your team.
We'll get the apologies in there early. You guys want to do some buy sell?
Yes.
Buy or sell, presented by Pristine Auction.
All right, buy or sell. Julio Jones, is he still a top 10 wide receiver in Dynasty at age 31? So does he make your own top 10 wide receivers in Dynasty? He's 31 years old. Some context for Julio. He's been kind of good. In half PPR leagues, six straight seasons of elite fantasy production. Wide receiver 8, 2, 6, 4, 5, 3 last year. Buying or selling Julio Jones as a top 10 wide receiver in Dynasty drafts?
I think this is a pretty good line, because while Julio is obviously a superstar NFL player and superstar fantasy wide receiver.
And he'll be a top 10 redraft player.
Yes, absolutely. Or wide receiver. Without a shadow of a doubt. He will be there in redraft coming into this season. But when you're looking at age 31, you go, okay, well, where does he land? There's six guys that I'm pretty sure everyone out there would, you know, put above Julio, being Michael Thomas, DeAndre Hopkins, DeVante Adams, Tyreek Hill.
Sammy Watkins.
No, and then depending on the quarterback situation in Tampa, you've got Chris Godwin and Mike Evans. So those young guys who are also superstars.
Wow, you're just casually... Juju Smith-Schuster, who was skyrocketing to be the literally the number one guy in fantasy football at the wide receiver position, and he's no longer a lock at your top seven?
Well, no. So what I'm saying is that I think those six are universal. I don't think that there's any debate for most people out there.
To Jason's point, Juju wasn't in that top six for me probably. So, I mean, I think some people wanted him to prove it for dynasty leagues.
I have Juju right now, personally, on my own dynasty wide receiver rankings at wide receiver 9.
Okay.
So he's not in mine.
Do you have OBJ?
I have OBJ at 10.
Okay. I was just curious. Those two. And very interesting.
But this is where, now these names are the ones that you're really comparing with Julio, right? What do you think about Odell Beckham and Juju? What do you think about Amari Cooper? Is he a superstar?
Yeah, he's so tough. Like, how old is Cooper?
Oh, he's super.
Like 25, 26.
Yeah, I think that's right. One of those. Amari Cooper is 25 years old. He will be 26 this season.
He's still so young.
I'm buying it. I'm buying Julio Jones as a top 10 wide receiver in dynasty leagues.
Hmm.
Dynasty is a different animal, no doubt about it. But philosophically speaking, when you play a dynasty league or you play a redraft league, you're playing to win the championship that year. Just because you're playing in a dynasty league does not mean you're playing to win some sort of championship that spans multiple years just because you assembled a team at a certain age range. And everybody can look at it and glance at it and say it's incredible. I understand you have to consider that, but you're still trying to win the title. And Julio Jones represents, I think, a great opportunity to win the championship over the next couple of years, delivering, you know, his worst season in that span was just under 1,400 receiving yards. That's not production that you can find all the time. And it's not production that you're going to guarantee yourself if one of these younger guys may or may not mature, the Jujus of the world, or OBJ off of injury, or any of those situations. So for me, I want Julio, even if the time span doesn't look as glorious as a Chris Godwin situation.
And there are a lot of people out there, dynasty lovers, who love to focus on age, and they very well might prefer to have DJ Moore, Kenny Golladay, Cortland Sutton, these type of players over Julio. Now, philosophically, I'm with you, Andy. I would rather have the Julio Jones. I want to win. You know, the last 2 years, I have won our dynasty championship with Julio. I'm not looking to unload him now because, I'm planning on, winning it again. But those are the questions. So if he's top 10 or if he's not top 10, it's just a matter of, would you rather have Julio or some of those DJ Moore, Kenny Golladay types. I feel like that's the question. So you were surprised by his buy. I'm buying Julio as a top 10.
I don't think I can have him in the top 10 anymore because he'll be a top 5 wide receiver this year, but he is 31. He's in that big wide receiver area where when it falls off, it kind of evaporates. We've seen it happen several times with players of his stature. So it just, if you're like, okay, your dynasty team, and I get that Julio Jones will likely outproduce those guys we're talking about this year. But we're talking just 1 year into the future, DJ Moore outproducing Julio Jones, it's in the realm of possibility. And then you have DJ Moore then for multiple years, and DJ Moore is 22. I mean, it's really hard to get Julio into the back of the top 10 for me.
It's a matter of whether you view Julio Jones as a generational type of player to me.
Because he was.
Because he's 31 years. Well, he just got signed to what? A $71 million contract extension or whatever the case may be. Terrell Owens was putting up elite fantasy production until he was 35 years old. If I told you you were getting Julio Jones at 1,400 yards a year for 3 more years.
Oh, then it's easy.
So I guess I don't believe the drop-off will happen that rapidly. I imagine that Matt Ryan will be just as productive for the next 3-4 years. So, no, I mean, I understand the argument. You have to make a decision about a player on the age side of the dynasty. I mean, is this player showing signs of decline?
It's not just age for Julio Jones. It's that, like, it feels like the big injury is about to happen every single week. It doesn't. I mean, he plays all the time, except for the year when he actually broke his foot. But he's always hobbled. So I mean, that's the risk of his health because of his size has to be kind of baked in there. So it's not that I won't argue and say, oh, it's foolish to have Julio Jones in the back of your top 10. It's just, it's a really interesting question when, and we didn't even bring up like AJ Brown. I know it was only 1 year and it was a kind of a flash in the pan, but AJ Brown looks like a top 15 guy easy at this point. And so somehow does he slide into the back of your top 10?
Yeah. Yeah, and it might make a difference the way your team's assembled. Two buys, one sell. That's buy or sell from Pristine Auction. Check them out. PristineAuction.com. Use the registration code BALLERS.
BALLERS.
Ooh. Ooh. To get a $10 credit towards your first purchase over
$10.
There. Let's check out the news.
News and notes from around the league.
Get hyped.
Julio's a big guy.
Yes.
He's really big.
Yes,
I mean, he's never really fit into that mold of being the, you know, on the goal line, soaking up the double-digit touchdowns. It's never been Julio. But I always believe that those guys that may lose the top-end speed, you know, Larry Fitzgerald had many years after he lost a step. I wonder if Julio's going to fit that category or not.
We'll see.
We'll find out.
Very interesting.
That's really what the question of top 10 is or not, is will he be able to do it in his 31 through 34, 35 year old age?
We're old. If Julio's 31 going on, we're
going on retired.
Yeah.
Then we're just old.
Yeah. I mean, have you seen your eye lately?
Oh,
it's really bad.
It's so much older than I am. Well, get hyped.
Yeah, yes. Go ahead.
Mike, this, why don't you take this away? Because this is your boy this last year.
Los Angeles Chargers, they have re-signed running back Austin Ekeler to a 4-year, $24.5 million contract. He was a restricted free agent. L.A. didn't even want to play the game at all. They said, Austin Ekeler, come back into the fold. You are the lead running back. That doesn't necessarily mean that it's coming in, it's Austin Ekeler nonstop all the time. But we at least have a little glimpse of what that could possibly be, because that was the first four or five weeks of last year where Austin Ekeler was, what, like the RB2?
Yeah, he
going
was
going through those things. And now we have some changes with Phillip Rivers being gone. Just saying, Austin Ekeler from undrafted to absolutely locking down the bag and being awesome. Congratulations, Mr. Ekeler.
And this, they're making a documentary about this called When Holdouts Go Wrong. Melvin Gordon trying to get that money holds out and looks like your backup is fine, and then he gets the money.
It reminded me of different position, but remember when Mike Wallace was supposed to get the huge extension from Pittsburgh
and
he scoffed at their money?
Yes.
And then Antonio Brown took the money?
Yeah. That worked out for the Steelers, but
you have to be happy for Austin Ekeler. I mean, it's a good deal. I Gordon will make more than this in his deal.
Yes.
But Ekeler secured.
But who will have more fantasy value?
I think it'll be Gordon. See, I didn't read this. I read this contract and said a few things. Like, this doesn't change the fact that there's quarterback tumult in Los Angeles.
Sure.
It doesn't change the fact that they could be turning to a rookie 3-4 games into the season. It simply changes the fact that Austin Ekeler, as a weapon in the offense, is secure. He's going to be part of that offense. I don't think they view him as, you know, Ezekiel Elliott. Not that they should or would, but it's great. I mean, Ekeler just put his nose down and worked hard and got a big payday. And
92
now he's
92 receptions.
He's a key part of the offense.
Well, and I think that's what Andy's speaking to. The biggest avenue for his fantasy value is the receiving game. And now if Tyrod Taylor is your quarterback, I'm not going to bank on the same dump-offs, the same rapport that he had with Philip Rivers. So he will have a role. It will be important to the Chargers. How valuable it will be for fantasy is going to be dictated, I believe, by who the quarterback is. We don't know that yet. And I'm guessing that that's going to nerf how I view about him.
That's fine.
It's funny, though.
You guys continue to doubt
Ekeler. It's not a doubting of Ekeler. It's being realistic about the type of player that he is. In the same way that, like, ironically, this same team, you know, paid a lot of money to Darren Sproles for a couple of years towards the end of his Chargers tenure. Darren Sproles was never going to be the between-the-tackles guy, and they don't expect Ekeler to be that. But you're right. I mean, he's a super valuable fantasy weapon. He's disproportionately more valuable because he's such a pass catcher.
Yeah.
And you deserve a victory lap for your trust and belief in Austin Ekeler in general, because he's a great player. He keeps tweeting pictures of himself.
He's very strong.
Jumping,
I don't know if you've been
and
following
he can jump
him.
Very, very high.
He is a ridiculous athlete.
Yeah. All right, Saints plan to use a first-round tender on restricted free agent Taysom Hill. This is according to Adam Schefter.
Okay.
I believe it when I see it.
I mean, that's a lot of money to pay a guy.
I feel like you could...
It's at least $4 million for that first-round tender.
I understand what they're doing. That he's valuable to the team, and they don't want someone to come scoop him away. Who's going to come and scoop him away, because they're not going to say... No one's coming in to say, hey, Taysom Hill, we're going to pay you quarterback money to be our starting quarterback. No one's going to come in and say, hey, gadget player, you want our money instead of the Saints?
It makes very little sense.
A little strange
for other teams, especially in the first year where there's a real quarterback free agency market. You got Brady and Tannehill and Teddy and all the just tons of Jameis, Philip Rivers. And
a first round tender is nothing, though, if they view Taysom as a backup quarterback.
True.
They're paying him half the amount of money. I think the Cardinals paid what, Mike Glennon $8 million
sure.
to be a backup a couple of years ago?
I guess through that lens, then it does make sense.
Yeah. Do they view him as that? I believe Sean Payton believes that he could make it work with Taysom Hill.
We'll find. Yeah. If they bring in another backup quarterback.
Then they should. I mean, they need to with losing Teddy, but. DeSean Jackson, he's confirmed he's back to 100% health. His 100% health meter, unfortunately, only goes up to 60%.
So, yeah, the problem is he said this a little bit ago, so it's already down to 92.
Right.
Yeah.
He turned 33 in December.
Oh, so old.
That being said, he hasn't really shown on film that he's lost any of his speed.
No, he's still great.
In a way, this is an offseason acquisition for Carson Wentz and the Eagles. If he is back to 100%, he is that deep threat that they needed last year. That he was supposed to be last year. I spent way too many episodes of this show talking about the fantasy impact that DeSean Jackson had had on every single quarterback he had ever played for, minus Jameis Winston. And so whether that continues on into this offseason, you know, regular season, I don't know. Jackson is getting up there. It's hard to imagine him, you know, that the Eagles are going to bank on him when it comes to free agency at the wide receiver position. You imagine they will build that up. So what are your guys' thoughts on D-Jax next year?
Yeah, I mean, he's great if he's out there, and that's all it is. Whether he's healthy, I mean, he could say he's 100% healthy, and that's great. take a hit, you know, and then play a game and then see if you come out of the game healthy. He'll be fine, I think, for DFS week one next year, a late round flyer for week one, you know, and start off strong. I think that's fine, but I'm not banking on his health at 33 when, you know, it's been 4 or 5 years since he's played a full season.
All right, before we get into some mailbag, answering some questions, we've got some voicemails, we have some Dynasty questions, all sorts. We're going to help you out. Before we do that, I want to thank today's sponsor. We're talking about Zoom.
Zoom!
Listen, when you use Zoom, Mike, every day is a little bit better. We're talking about Zoom Video Communications with the web's best-reviewed video conferencing service. It's used by millions to meet one-on-one or hundreds at a time. You know, the last 5 years of running this business, look how much interaction is going on online. Yep. I mean, almost everything. And Zoom knows how to do it better than everybody else. They let you connect face-to-face with anyone across town, around the world. They use flawless video, crystal clear audio. Mike, you like that audio quality.
It better be crystal clear.
Instant sharing of video, documents, files, spreadsheets, all those things.
It's a great service.
You can share those files, collaborate in real time. They just do it better than everybody else. And so the question that we have for you, if you're not using Zoom video conferencing, why not? That's the question I have for you.
It's why.
Visit Zoom online and set up a free account today. Try the most affordable and most reliable video communication solution on the market. Meet happy with Zoom.
Mailbag.
Mailbag. Zoom.
Can't even imagine trying a mailbag drop right now.
Oof.
I mean, it was already going to be a max of 2 out of 10.
Mailbag.
Just silence. Like I could do sound effects for like some ghost horror movies.
Ooh.
Stuff like that.
There's like a whistle in the background, but it's you just screaming. Like,
Why can't we nail this wind sound?
All right. Mailbag time. Let's jump in with a question from Twitter. Alec has a question. Starting a Dynasty League this season, and I know you guys are against kickers in fantasy, but how do you feel about defenses in Dynasty Leagues?
So, I'm fine with them. I'm fine without them. Our main Dynasty Leagues do not have defenses. Played in plenty of Dynasty Leagues that have them, and I've never, in those leagues, I haven't thought to myself, like, I hate this. Whereas with kickers, it's like, this is unnecessary and, it causes problems for half the league on a position that nobody cares about and yada, yada. At least with defenses, you can draft good franchises. They never get injured. And, you know, you're used to playing with them. So I'm not opposed.
It's a preference thing. And ultimately, there's so much to think about in Dynasty Leagues that I prefer not to have the defenses be a part of that equation. But
I must say, For Anonymous Jason to say that he's fine on both sides, I'm incredibly disappointed.
No fire there.
Yeah, nice hard stance. Oh, I'm fine with it. Like, and we do have some Brooks feedback because he's not here, so he wanted to make sure we had this feedback that because we have no defenses in our Dynasty League, he wants to remove defenses completely. So we have swayed.
Like from redraft
leagues. Brooks. Yeah, he's now against DSTs.
I think anybody who had the Patriots last year is against this, and everyone else would be for that.
Yeah, I would say I'd leave them out. That's my vote. Final vote.
I like defenses in redraft. I don't want them. I don't have to worry about that in my Dynasty League.
All right, let's get to a new question so I can just have real fire.
You want a real fire? Okay, let's go to the voicemail.
Hey, footballers. I need some serious help here. I've been offered 2.1 for Alexander Mattison in the half-point Superflex Dynasty League. I think it's a great deal, but I know with the Vikings cap situation, Mattison might be the RB1 there in 2 years. Thanks, guys, for the year-round advice.
No freaking way. No way it's not Dalvin Cook. Their caps, they're not moving on from Dalvin Cook.
He said in 2 years.
Yeah, I know what he said, and it's not happening.
Oh, he's trying to be really profound with his sunglasses
now. It's not happening.
How are they re-signing him?
I want, with money, the cap goes up every single year. Every time that teams say they have no cap space, they go, and then all of a sudden they sign someone to a
map. That was the sound of accounting.
That was, and then all of a sudden they sign massive contracts. Dalvin Cook is one of the biggest names and faces of that franchise. He's going to be the guy. So I'm going to take the shot at having a starter. I mean, Alexander Mattison could be the starter with injury, but otherwise,
give me the 201.
Yes, 100%.
Give me the 201 completely. Look, no disrespect to Alexander Mattison, but you know, for every one of these backups that turns into a valuable fantasy player later on, there's 10 that don't. And 201 is an opportunity to capture value immediately, potentially, with that pick. And Mattison is a matter of banking on injury, and it's banking on contract, and it's banking on opportunity. So,
and this is a deep draft class with the amount of quality running backs and wide receivers here. I feel like the 201, I consider that more like a back end first than a usual second round or just going year in, year out.
The fact that it was a super flex. So with the quarterbacks going additionally at the beginning of this draft, it will push good players down. So I feel like I am the Mattison truther of the show. Even I would prefer to have the 201, but I'm definitely not nearly as bullish as you are, Jason, that Dalvin Cook gets re-signed.
That's because you don't have any sunglasses on.
Yeah,
right now.
You want to wear these?
You want me to, you want
the, no, no. We won't do that to the people.
We have Al Borland just blacking out one camera right now.
You all almost right. heard about top five pick Alexander Mattison.
if you had taken the sunglasses.
Right. Yeah. But I won't say that.
No, because you're Mike, right? You're not anonymous.
I'm restrained. I'm a regular person.
All right. This question comes in. Well, let's do another voicemail.
Hey, ballers. My name's Jason. I'm in a PPR league where I get to keep either Terry McLaurin, DJ Chark, or DeVante Parker in the 10th round. I'm leaning towards Parker, depending on his QB, of course, but I really love Terry McLaurin. Love to hear your thoughts on this. Thanks, guys. Keep up the good work.
Terry McLaurin, DJ Chark, DeVante Parker for a 10th rounder. Who would you rather have?
Really, really interesting names in this list. If I knew that Ryan Fitzpatrick was going to be the quarterback for 16 games, then DeVante Parker, I think he showed how consistent he was. He's a top 10 guy pretty much the entire second half of the year. But if they go out and draft a high-profile quarterback like they are projected to do, then I'm not confident there.
I'm going to take DeVante Parker here. And the reason for that is if your scenario comes true, like, okay, if he has Fitzpatrick, he's great. If he doesn't, then he devolves into the same situation Terry McLaurin's already in.
Yeah, but to me, it's between DeVante Parker and DJ Chark. DJ Chark, you know, got off to such a strong start last year. You know, when he ended up with Minshew, he was phenomenal. Now I expect Minshew to come in, win the job. And, you know, DJ Chark dealt with injuries the second half of the year. So I agree with you that, you know, okay, then it's a bad situation like Terry McLaurin already has. But where do you stand between those
this
three?
Is a really, really difficult situation because I don't want to just buy into the fact, okay, DeVante Parker was a top 10 guy last year. Let's just take the guy who finishes top 10 and not even – like account for how awesome Terry McLaurin was, and that was his rookie year. I mean, he's gonna make the jump. Like the second year jump could happen for Terry McLaurin and launch him into becoming an elite player at the wide receiver position. He will be hamstrung likely by Haskins, but Haskins showed a little bit. Washington's also flirting with the idea that they just grab a different quarterback. So I don't want to instantly dismiss Terry McLaurin. Is, man, this is a really, really difficult question to answer right now. I think if I had to do it, just lock it in right now, I would probably still end up taking Parker.
I think that's okay. I mean, because you talk about taking a second-year leap or something from McLaurin. Look, we all love Terry McLaurin, the talent here. Parker put up 1,209.
Right,
so he took the leap.
Yeah, I you know, and again,
the year five leap
that that everyone was waiting for. It was classic year five leap.
Yeah, that's the year where you always go from about 300 yards receiving and one touchdown to about 1,209.
But
in year five,
and then I know we all watched Parker and we saw it. This wasn't. It didn't look fluky. But what are the chances for DeVante Parker that was just this one magical season he had with Fitzpatrick where he just kind of had it figured out, and then he goes back to being...
I would say 1 in 5.
yeah, no. But if I set the line at 1,000 yards receiving and 5 touchdowns, are you giving the nod to McLaurin? Are you giving the nod to Parker to hit that mark next year?
I think that's a good way to look at it. I would give the nod to DeVante Parker. I think he's the safest of these three, and I don't know how much more upside McLaurin or Chark have over Parker. So I'm going Parker here.
Mike's right. I mean, it's not an easy question, and it's one that you'd like to delay your answer on for as long as possible.
I'm sure he just asked because it's fun. This is what it's like we're us with our keepers. I'm still doing the keeper dance.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't have to lock him in for, 2 months?
Now, the best is when you think you've made your mind up, so you tell everyone around the office.
Yes.
You're like, guys, I figured out what I'm going to do. It's definitely these players and these players. And then, a week later, you're like, yeah, I've completely changed my mind because I've played out another scenario.
Well, did you hear this clown over here is trying to send Melvin Gordon to Detroit so he can blow up all my keepers.
Talking about anonymous Jason?
Yes.
Well, this was real Jay. No, this was Jason FFL.
I don't know if you guys know this, but I was actually on that episode.
Were you?
That you were talking about that. Yes. Mm. I was sitting there in that chair, Mike, saying nothing.
Oh, I don't recall. You weren't here.
And Jason completely buried the fact that I had picked Gordon to Detroit before he did. So now
so
we've got two of us
to
trying
me.
To root you. Ruin.
I see what's going on.
So
I see what's happening.
But I couldn't say anything. So YouTube community question from Brady. Have any of you guys ever masked your true thoughts on a player on the podcast in order to help your own fantasy football team?
No.
Basically leaning into hype you don't actually believe in.
No.
Maybe in the first three episodes of the show about 5 years ago.
So we haven't done this. It sucks because a lot of times I don't want to say something on the show, but I will always, always, always say it even if it is to my own detriment. If I'm trying to trade for a player and I know they're going to hear me talk them up, I'm always Foot Clan first. And I know all three of us are. We will always speak what we believe to be true. But I do remember the email correspondence that we found between you two gentlemen when you were contemplating starting this whole venture about doing this, and your biggest worry was that.
Yes.
That you were emailing back and forth and like, oh, man, but then all of the league mates would know what we want, and that was a legit concern.
We
won
three straight title matches. You guys were terrible.
We were making also $0 from the podcast. So it was a matter of, look, that league was more important at the time. I can tell you now that when we spend our Sundays rooting on games, it's about whether our picks come to fruition for the Foot Clan more than it is our teams. And if they can both align, it is a great and wonderful Sunday.
That's a great Sunday.
Yes, it is.
All right, let's go ahead and this is another important YouTube community question here. For draft potlucks, do you bring chili with or without beans? Ooh. Discuss your preference, chili with or without beans, for those draft potlucks. By the way, youtube.com/thefantasyfootballers.
Look, I'm a meat eater, okay, and I love meat. But chili has beans. That's how I view it. Like, beanless chili is...
I think you...
It's meat sauce.
Yeah, exactly. That's 100%
right.
Which
is super good.
I'm not disparaging meat sauce.
I could take some meat sauce.
I like meat. I would eat plenty of meat sauce, but it's not chili.
Yeah, I mean, you are correct in the fact that, like, if you get chili without beans, it's called chili with no beans. Like, it's not...
It's right. Not chili. It's
not called chili.
Here's the problem,
with
though.
Added beans. Am I wrong?
I've had the chili with too much beans.
Sure. I don't want just bean chili. Meatless
That's
chili.
Bean sauce. That's bean sauce.
You want bean sauce or meat sauce? No, just give me some chili.
That's a nice combination of the two.
I think we've broke this down in a real way here.
Yeah. All right.
If I had to choose between chili with too much beans or chili with no beans and just meat, I would go that side.
So apparently, right, according to Google, the proper definition of chili is the correct marriage of bean and meat.
Oh, all right. So we did it.
I made that up. What?
Oh, okay. Because you didn't Google it. All right. I think we've exhausted that one.
Yeah.
Instagram question from Kyle Besh. How do you guys compare future draft picks versus current players in dynasty leagues when considering trade offers?
So usually I am going to prefer existing players over draft picks because one has proven they can do it in the NFL and one hasn't. There's a lot more upside and risk with draft picks over what you know you have. But I mean, you know, it's really Dynasty more than redraft has so much philosophy in how you want to build a roster. I think all three of us are much more on the side of having veterans and known commodities who just help you actually win a championship versus potential and hope of being dominant someday.
I want to illustrate that point, if you'll give me a moment.
No.
Well, never
all
mind
right.
that. No.
Okay.
I just want to read to you the second round picks from last year's rookie draft.
All right.
Straight through. All right. Andy Isabella. Mm. Paris Campbell. Mm-hmm. Hakeem Butler.
Uh-oh.
J.J. Arcega-Whiteside. Noah Fant.
Who picked that one?
Do you want that was you, Jason.
Oh, okay. Good pick.
Are you taking a victory lap on Fant right now? All right. Do you want that one to count as a good pick?
Yes.
All right. Justice Hill. Devin Singletary.
Oh, great pick.
There we go.
Dwayne Haskins. Irv Smith.
Ooh, big Irv.
Damian Harris. Alex Barnes. Rodney Anderson.
Hey, that one can't, that one's a great pick.
It's not that the picks aren't valuable.
I heard one good pick.
It's not that the picks aren't valuable. But and then if you go beyond that, Miles Boykin, Mattison, Bryce Love, Mike Weber, Darwin Thompson, Deontay Johnson.
That's I count that one for sure. And
dang,
it's not even
steal
that
in the third round.
But good friend of the show, Ryan McDowell, he recently tweeted out the first round ADP of like how many years do we got here? Like 6 years or so. If you want to see a horror show, go look at the draft picks because it is just brutal. And we're talking as early as 2018. Saquon, okay, easy peasy. Everyone was going to take Saquon. Darius Geis
hasn't worked out.
Nick Chubb, great pick. Rashad Penny, Ronald Jones, Sony Michel, Royce Freeman. DJ Moore, great pick. I mean, but like
that's the first round.
Yeah, that's the first.
Those are the
round.
Highest, and that's the point here is that what you know and see with the you know, we talk about all these metrics that are sticky. What is the greatest way when you're looking at rookies and when you're looking at redraft? What is the greatest methodology to find success? And there is literally nothing that comes anywhere near as close to previous success.
Yes, in the NFL.
If you've done it, you can do it and probably will again until you hit the end of your career or some, you know, major shift on your team. So yeah, we're usually a vet over draft pick type of.
Yeah. And if you look at last year's first round, it was much better. There were a handful, you know, that Daryl Henderson didn't make an impact, Nikhil Harry didn't make an impact, Hockenson, you know, really not great.
Yeah, we'll see.
Everybody else in our first round was okay. Jacobs and Sanders, Montgomery, Kyler Murray, Metcalf, A.J. Brown. But 30 NFL rookies aren't taking over the NFL offenses each and every year.
Correct.
All right. This one from Twitter. Sorry, actually from Instagram. From
oh, my.
Baguardian.
Oh.
Hey, ballers. Love the show. I want to join Baguardian. A dynasty league. I want to join a dynasty league. Where does this brother from another mother go to figure that out? And then he gives up a fist bump.
Yeah, I mean, so. There's a lot of different places, but if you don't know where to go, I would recommend footclanleagues.com. Foot Clan Leagues, that's, you know, look, that's our people. That's our audience, our listeners. You can join online leagues. You can join local leagues. Get to know some friends in your area. You know, everybody that is there, obviously, is they're more committed. And, you know, they're like-minded in the sense that they're coming from this show. They like fantasy to be taken serious, but also have a ton of fun.
Well, think about this. Sometimes people view this show, this is to our own viral detriment, as the secret, right? You find the show and you don't want to tell anybody about it. So why go join a league with other people that might listen to the show? Because it's a lot better than playing in a league with four or five, six people that don't care and ruin the league for everybody else. A competitive environment, a fun environment, one filled with trades and communication and all of those dynamics, thinking up the right rules and the right ways to play, that's more fun. That's more enjoyable.
It's like, why do I keep playing pickleball against Al Borland?
Nobody knows.
Right, because
What's
you just
point?
Keep beating up
I
on
just
him,
keep beating him over and over and over.
You need to find a league. FootClanLeagues.com.
FootClanLeagues.com.
Pickleball leagues. We're adding them.
Happy birthday, brother.
That's 100% not true.
I mean, it's just to be clear, it's 100% true today.
That is 100% true.
Okay. Yes. All right. YouTube question. Andrew Nelson, Kenyon Drake or Austin Ekeler in 2020?
I will go with Kenyon Drake. I assume he will get more money than Austin Ekeler got.
To me, this is 100%. What are the chances that Kenyon Drake ends up back on the Cardinals? And I have that as a low percentage, so I will take Austin Ekeler.
I was going to say, if you're deciding right now then, so you're taking Ekeler, I'll take Drake. I think he's going...
If he doesn't go to the Cardinals and someone else pays him a good chunk of money, it's going to be a great... He's going to go to Houston or he's going to go to...
He's been in a different system and had no fantasy success.
Austin Ekeler was a top running back this year. Kenyon Drake has had
eight
good games in his career.
But I contest that. I say that that's incorrect.
Okay.
No, because of facts and history. Go back and look. Now, here's the thing. I have always loved Kenyon Drake. I've been a supporter of truth for a long time. He never got the workload. But do you remember the stretches where everyone around him got injured and then he was thrust into those workloads and had like a half a season where, I mean, I know if you look at season totals, they're not going to be great, but look at the context of when he's done it with the Dolphins, with Adam Gase, and he dominated certain stretches. He's shown it on the field. That's my opinion and facts.
Like I said, like 8 weeks.
Yeah. He's shown it in spurts. He's not shown it over the course of a whole season, and he fit like a glove in the Kingsbury system. So it's a matter... I agree with Mike. It's all about what you believe Kenyon Drake's destination might be.
If Drake's back in Arizona, hands down, I'll take Kenyon Drake.
Are you taking Kenyon Drake if he's signed as part of some sort of platoon in Houston?
Yep.
You take him over Ekeler?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, now he actually is disrespecting Austin Ekeler.
I'm not. I believe Kenyon Drake is a very, very good running back.
And what do you believe about Ekeler?
I think he is an exceptional pass catcher, and I'm not sure how that role will be there without Phillip Rivers. If that's disrespecting Austin Ekeler, then guilty.
The truth is despite the spurs for Kenyon Drake, you cannot contend that he's had or shown the ability, much like Lamar Miller when he left Miami, to carry the work over the long part of, you know, an entire season as the guy. 133 carries, 120 carries, 170 carries.
Yes, he's never been given the opportunity. When he was with Adam Gase, I mean, look at 2017, right? 2017, here's what happened. His attempts through that year when he was in this platoon, 6, 9, 7, 7, 9, everybody gets injured. Then he gets 23, 25, 16. The rest of the season, he was on pace for 291 carries, 1,400 yards. I mean, he just didn't get the opportunity. You're 100% right. He has never had the opportunity to show it.
I feel like you're talking about Lamar Miller. I mean, this is exactly what happened with Lamar Miller. Three years with the Dolphins, 5.1 a carry, 4.5 a carry, 194 carries, 216 carries, got all the work, efficiency went down. That's a risk with Kenyon Drake.
Yes, and I'm not saying he's going to be some top five back, but Lamar Miller, while he very much disappointed because he wasn't that top five, top six back.
He was
back,
still fine for
he
fantasy.
He was actually really good. Yeah. He just wasn't good compared to what we hoped. But you know, Lamar Miller wasn't, you know, a bad fantasy option.
No, but he didn't deliver. We've just seen that a lot. He didn't deliver. It's the CJ Spiller effect, you know.
Like Lamar Miller was like running back 10 or 12 or something
like that.
Like that,
yeah.
Yeah. What was Austin Ekeler this last year?
I don't have it pulled up.
Anonymous answer. It's a fair debate. That's why it was a question.
Yeah.
All right. YouTube question. Of you three, this is from John Anderson. Of you three, who is the most obnoxious winner?
I honestly used to think it was me.
I don't think it's been a while. I don't think it's you.
So we don't remember.
I thought it was me, but it's not.
Yeah, I don't think it's you.
No. It's Jason.
Probably.
I think
Andy
it's Jason.
What are you talking about?
It's Jason. But also, we can follow that up with who's the most annoying loser.
Oh, it's definitely me. That one
is Jason.
There is no doubt who's the worst loser. That's this guy. So
I don't know why this question's in here, but it's also Jason. Uncle Chewy says, out of the footballer,
Chewbacca,
who wins a naked mud wrestling match?
Yeah, that would definitely be me.
It's also Jason.
Go with the weight.
I would.
And then you got some jiu-jitsu skills.
Yeah. How fast can you turn and run and leap out of a ring? Because that would be my strategy. If I see naked Jason straight across from me, and I'm like, what am I doing in this rest? I turn and I run and I dive.
No.
I will be an obnoxious
And I probably
winner.
Get, yeah. get some rope burn in places I don't want it on my way out of that ring. Okay. Goodness gracious. Are these all from you, Al Borland?
Every one of them.
Every one of these is from you? Okay.
The hardest part was making up unique names for each one.
All right. Twitter. you're pretending that it was you who actually wrote the questions.
Yeah.
I just meant put them in the doc. You wrote them all and made up names.
Yeah, you did.
Got it. All right. Brett Garten from Twitter.
What
says,
a great name.
When it comes to making projections, what's the most important thing you guys look at? Was that answered in your previous success question, Jason?
Well, I mean, we usually don't even include that, you know, but because it's so obvious, but that's probably true. The most important thing is having done it before. If you take that out, I think that's the spirit of the question, is kind of what are some of the things that you look for the most? And I would say percentage of a total is one of the things that I look at, whether that's target market share or
it's opportunity.
Yeah, that's the word I was going to use, is opportunity.
Yeah, and so what I like to do is you look at what you believe a team is going to do. Are they going to be on the higher end, the lower end, middle of the pack? And you've got the data for what range that puts a team at for carries, for you know, passing yards, for all these things. And then you break it down positionally, and you look at each player and say, okay, it's not realistic that this guy's going to get 45% of the team's targets, and that's what these stats might imply. So you got to adjust those things to where they're realistic historically.
All right, Chris wants to know, would you trade McCole Hardman for the 203 rookie pick in a 14-team dynasty league, or would it take more? I also have the 208. Should I throw that in as well?
Oh, so Chris is trying to get Hardman.
Yeah. I don't think 203 is enough for Hardman.
I would
not trade Hardman. Or if I had Hardman, I would not accept the 203. You would have to bring more.
Would you accept the 203 and the 208? That seems maybe more in the ballpark, but we just read a bunch of second round picks and only one of them looked nice.
I think so. If he's the one going after Hardman, I think that you can offer the 203. And then add the 208 if necessary. I would be willing to trade both of those for Hardman. So, yeah.
So you'd rather have Hardman than both those picks?
Correct.
Yeah, I think I would too. I mean, if Sammy Watkins truly is gone from Kansas City, I mean, that's a factor that we don't know right now. We've had our weird, vague booking from Sammy Watkins on Twitter and kind of implying a new path is about to open up for him. I mean, if he is gone.
Well, it's not even a matter. DeMarcus Robinson, isn't he in?
Yeah, DeMarcus Robinson is also a free agent.
They're not going to be able to afford to bring him back, I doubt, considering their cap issues and their struggles with Sammy. So there's a potential here that DeMarcus Robinson and Sammy aren't there. But even if one of those guys certainly won't be there. And that right there is enough of a pathway.
When you talk about second year jump, too, more time in Reed system. As a dynasty owner, McCole Hardman, really like the sound of this conversation.
I have this season.
Yeah, I wish he was on my team.
I have looked up in our league. I was like, okay, I'm going after Hardman. I looked him up, and I saw he was on your team, Andy.
You gave up?
You have never received an offer because I know that you like him and you get it as well. So, yeah, take this as a compliment to you and all Hardman owners out there.
You've never made an offer in those sunglasses, Jason. You might be able to bring a real deal. My way with those sunglasses.
I'll take a look soon.
So you can take a shot. All right, that's going to do it for today's episode. Check us out on YouTube, youtube.com/TheFantasyFootballer. Subscribe, click the bell. We're going to put some interesting content up there very soon.
Also, you might be saying, well, I thought this was supposed to be the coaching changes episode. Very important episode every offseason. That is coming this week. We wanted a little bit more time for research. Andy's voice.
Yeah, your eyeball. Brooks to get back.
That will be our next show. Don't miss it.
Thursday. Absolutely. Thanks for tuning in.
We'll talk
to you soon.
We'll see you on Thursday, everybody. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com. and follow us on Twitter at the FF Ballers.